sponsored by Omaze. As good and cheap as solar and wind power are for generating clean electricity, the intermittency of their power generation creates a problem. You generate too much energy when you don't need it, and you don't have enough energy when you do need it. That's why energy storage is key for a future built on renewables. We have the technology available today to build out massive, grid-scale energy storage systems using lithium-ion batteries, flow batteries, and pump hydro storage systems. But the logistics around building those can be slow and costly. There's a potentially faster way to build out a large-scale energy storage system and do it virtually. About a year ago, I had a Tesla Powerwall installed at my house. Not only has it been helping to stretch my solar power generation into the night, but I've been participating in a virtual power plant system with over 1,000 other homeowners in my area. Let's take a look at my experience with the Powerwall and if a virtual power plant can be a viable path for the future of energy storage. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. So about a year ago, I had my Tesla Powerwall installed, which I did a video on and detailed my installation experience. And if you haven't seen that video, I'd strongly recommend checking it out because I'm kind of the poster boy for what not to do. The bottom line, I had a horrible experience with my installer. However, not too long ago, I had a Span smart electric panel installed, which I also have a video on if you're interested in that. And they helped to clean up and fix all of my Powerwall installation problems that I had. Since November of 2020, my Powerwall has been helping to shift a decent amount of my excess solar production into the evening and some of the night. I only have one Powerwall, which isn't enough to contain all of my excess production during the summer, so I'm still exporting a large amount of electricity back into the grid. And in my area, I have full net metering, which gives me a one-to-one payback. For every kilowatt hour I put into the grid, my utility wipes off 1 kilowatt hour off of my account. Every time I mention this, I inevitably get someone who doesn't live in my area commenting that I'm mistaken about that. And I'm wrong, which I find really, really funny. They typically reference what net metering pays back in their area. It's not a universal credit, so you've got to look into it for your area. Mine is one-to-one. I get 100% of the value back, which in essence makes the grid act like a giant battery for me, cost-wise. That actually makes home batteries look like a bad return on investment in my area. And that brings up the giant question of why someone would want to go through the trouble of getting a home battery installed. Is it worth it? The answer to that is going to vary based on your goals, but that basically boils down to a combination of three motivations: saving money, environmental concerns, and emergency backup and energy independence. You may only care about one of those three motivational buckets or all three, so you have to evaluate this based on that. For me, I'm most concerned about the first two, but don't want to break the bank doing so. So the money angle is still somewhat a part of it. Which brings me back to net metering. If I did receive a partial net metering rebate, like a lot of you have brought up in the comments on previous videos, like a utility that only pays me wholesale prices for each kilowatt hour that I put back into the grid, then a battery would start working its price off by getting me back the full value of each kilowatt hour, including the lost delivery fees, by holding onto that energy for myself. We also don't have time of use rates in my area, which is another way home batteries can help pay for themselves. This helps you pay for electricity from the grid when it's cheap, like in the middle of the night, and use electricity from the battery when the grid is most expensive, typically in the evenings. Now again, in my area, this is another knock against a battery investment. From a pure cost perspective, I get no financial gain from time shifting my energy use or hoarding the electricity generated from my solar panels for myself. But that's where virtual power plants come in. But before I get into that, how would you like to support an amazing charity with an opportunity to win a $4.3 million Los Angeles dream house? Today's sponsor, Omaze, is running a fundraiser for the charity Rebuilding Together. They're devoted to repairing the homes of veterans, people with disabilities, and neighbors with low incomes to help keep our communities intact. Rebuilding Together has helped to revitalize entire neighborhoods, improve parks, schools, and community centers. They've also been involved in helping with recovery efforts after natural disasters. It's a great charity that's making a meaningful difference in people's lives. Donate $10 and you're automatically entered for a chance to win the big prize, which is an insane 5-bedroom, 6-bath, $4.3 million home in Los Angeles. It has everything, including an in-home movie theater, pool, and basketball court. Oh, and I almost forgot, the putting green. This house has everything that you can dream of for a house that's also located in the center of entertainment, Los Angeles. You have the option to choose a multi-million dollar cash prize instead, but this house looks amazing. Now enter for your chance to win this $4.3 million dream home in Los Angeles and support the fantastic charity Rebuilding Together. Go to omaze.com/Matt Ferrell, and thanks to Omaze and all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to where virtual power plants come in. In New Hampshire, Massachusetts, and Connecticut, there's a program that's available through National Grid and Eversource, which is my utility. Homeowners who have home batteries or inverters from Enphase, Generac, Solark, SolarEdge, Sonin, and Tesla can enroll in the Connected Solutions program. You may have seen or heard of similar programs like this springing up around the world. One of the first ones I heard about was for Tesla's virtual power plant system that they set up in Australia. Just recently, Tesla announced that they're expanding that system. By linking thousands of smaller home batteries using software, they can create one massive virtual battery. And none of the test virtual power plant systems that I found rival the largest purpose-built grid-scale batteries out there. For instance, Tesla's Hornsdale Power Reserve can supply 150 megawatts of power, while many of these virtual power plant systems are just a few megawatts. Now, in my area, there are 1,264 systems enrolled in the Eversource Connected Solutions program. When you sign up, you're allowing the utility to use your battery for load shedding, which helps moments of peak demand. The program's in effect during the summer months between July 1st and September 30th, when the electricity use is the highest. And each event can last for 3 hours and will fall between 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. They limit the number of events per participant to 30 to 60 per summer. And the incentive that you'll receive is $225 per the average kilowatt that your system provides into the grid. Not kilowatt hours, but kilowatts. In my case, I have one Powerwall, which means I'm contributing a max of about 5.8 kilowatts. So obviously my average will be somewhere below that, because it's going to fluctuate based on what I'm drawing from the battery at the same time. They only take the excess capacity that my home wasn't using at the time. If my house was pulling 2 kilowatts for itself, then they could only pull about 3 kilowatts, which hits my single Powerwall's capacity. This past summer, I saw about 34 events in my logs. And if you're curious what this looks like, here's one of the ones from July 20th. You can see how the battery hit 100% charge for my solar panel production at around 11 a.m. The rest of the afternoon, my house was running completely off of solar power, with some excess going off into the grid. Sometime before 5 p.m., my battery started discharging whatever I wasn't currently using at that moment. It worked out to about 3.4 kilowatts of power output for that session. Again, that's not kilowatt hours, but kilowatt output. By about 7 p.m., the event was over and my battery went back to normal operation, and that meant sitting at its minimum charge level, which I had set to 20% during the summer. Now, overall, we never noticed that any of this was happening in the background, day to day, over the summer. Now, based on the averages I've seen cited, you can probably expect around $1,000 paid out for a single Powerwall, minus Tesla's cut that they take to manage the program. Now, I've received one check so far for $772, and my Powerwall will be part of the system for 5 years, so I may end up getting around $4,000 total once the program is over. Given that a single Powerwall currently costs about $8,500 plus installation, this is not going to pay for itself. But it's a decent dent into the cost of the system. The more battery capacity you have, the more you can earn. If I had 2 Powerwalls, the payback could end up covering 1 full Powerwall plus a little bit of the second. Now, I asked Eversource how the system performed this year in my area, and like I mentioned, there's 1,264 homes participating, which ended up providing 2 megawatts of load shedding for the grid. And there was an average of 5 kilowatt load shed per battery installation. That means an average payout of $1,125. What I find interesting is that Sonin battery owners get the full amount, but Tesla Powerwall owners end up losing a small percentage to Tesla for maintenance fees. And the most interesting part of the program is that it was created by the utilities in an effort to save themselves money. And the payouts are coming from the benefits the program provides. Pilot programs like this have shown a lot of promise. Green Mountain Power launched a similar program in Vermont that paid back in a big way. In 2018, the network of batteries reduced consumption during New England peak hour, and saved about $600,000 in capacity fees. In 2019, after adding more batteries to the system for about 10 megawatts of capacity, it saved about $900,000 from a single hour of operation in late July peak. So you can start to see why utilities are willing and able to offer to pay customers to contribute to systems just like this. In fact, National Grid in Rhode Island offers $400 per kilowatt during summer events in the Connected Solutions program. Almost makes me want to move to Rhode Island. Almost. In Massachusetts, if you install a battery and solar panel system under the new Smart program, you can be enrolled in the Smart Battery Adder, which will pay you an additional amount of money based on the size of your solar panel system. For instance, if you have an average system of about 8 kilowatts here in Massachusetts, you could be paid an additional $237 to $732 a year. And it pays out over a course of 10 years, which means an additional $2,000 to $7,000 on top of the virtual power plant program. So my area may not make sense financially speaking for time-shifting energy use or net metering shortfalls, but through those other incentive programs, you could erase an additional $6,000 to $12,000 for a single battery, depending on your solar panel and battery capacity. That's in the realm of covering the cost of the full battery and installation. But all of that brings me back to those three main motivations: saving money, environmental concerns, and emergency backup and energy independence. As I just went through, cost-wise in my area, you could make a battery make some financial sense depending on your specific setup. For environmental concerns, it makes perfect sense to maximize your solar production to try to reduce your home's carbon footprint. And by participating in programs like virtual power plants, you're helping your local community by reducing the need for dirty coal or natural gas peaker plants spinning up as much. And because of your battery storage, you're helping to reduce the effects of flooding the grid with too much renewable energy in the middle of the day when it isn't needed. That helps maintain a healthier grid. That last motivation of energy independence and emergency backup is a little trickier. It's all about what you're willing to pay to achieve those goals. It's about quality of life. Now, when I've talked about blackouts in previous videos, a lot of folks, mainly in Europe, leave comments asking if blackouts really are that bad here. It really depends on where you live. Now, I'm in the northeast of the US, where we have a pretty old grid infrastructure, which is mainly power lines above the ground on telephone poles. We sometimes get hurricane force winds with winter nor'easter storms, freezing rain or very heavy snow that can stick to the lines and weigh them down, or falling branches from trees that take out the power lines. In my area, it's not that bad, but it does happen once or twice a year at most. In fact, since I've had a Powerwall, there have been 3 blackouts, 2 that were under 5 minutes, and a 3rd that lasted for 2 hours. With the Powerwall, we barely noticed. I have friends a few towns away that have power go out 6 times every single winter. It really depends on where you live. Now, I know families that have installed natural gas or diesel generators with whole home backup that costs thousands of dollars to install, and they serve only one purpose, electricity in a blackout. Batteries can do that, plus save you a little extra money along the way. So do I think it's been worth it for me? Well, yes, but I've got a special case here. My Powerwall was part of the Tesla referral program, so I only paid for the installation. But my wife and I are actually in the process of building a new home, which we'll be moving into in about a year or so, fingers crossed. For that house, I'm going to 100% be installing solar panels and a battery system. In fact, I want a bigger battery system than I have here. So I'll be putting my money where my mouth is. In my area and for my motivation, it's a big yes, but you'll have to decide that for yourself. And if you're interested in researching solar panels and batteries for yourself, I'd strongly recommend checking out Energysage as a great resource. They have great articles and reviews of products, and you can use Energysage to find a local installer. I used Energysage to find a solar installer on my current home, and I loved the experience. After that, I actually joined their affiliate program. So if you live in the US, you can use my portal to get free quotes from local, reputable installers in your area. Check out the link in the description. Even if you're not going to use them to find your installer, they have great reviews and articles that you can use for research. So far, there's been over 5 megawatts of solar installed through my portal. That's like taking over 18,000 cars off the road. I absolutely love that. So what do you think? Would you want a battery for your home, or would you want to participate in a virtual power plant system like this? Jump in the comments and let me know. And thanks as always to my patrons, and a big welcome to new Supporter Plus member David Sprong, and new producers, I'm going to butcher some names here, William Von Vechten, Jim Nyhaus, Russell Overland, Joel Welter, and Michael McLaughlin Brown. All of your direct support really helps with producing these videos and helps to reduce the dependence on the almighty YouTube algorithm. So speaking of which, if you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here, and subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.